What is up, guys? 3.9 League Metamorph, excuse me, is finally here. Now, in this freaking league, you get body parts from all your enemies that you kill, and you make this weird combobulated freaking monster from putting all little body parts into a weird tube thing. Yeah, and you make some OP monster. Now, effectively, this creates a boss that uses all the skills of all the monsters that you inputted into it. So that means that in this league, I can kind of shine because my builds are kind of balanced between clear speed and boss killing. You know, I do like builds that clear shit super freaking quick, but then I feel really bad when those super quick builds can't do shit about a boss or a monster with high life. And unfortunately, I don't like that at all. So let's get on to it. In this little presentation video, whatever the hell you want to call it, we're making three builds. One bow build, because this is a bow based league, they got buffed, a melee build, and a spellcaster build. Now, the reason I do this is because you never know. It's one for everybody. I have to make everybody happy, you know? So if you don't like bow builds for whatever reason, I give you two other options. Now, of course, they all meet the criteria of being easy to build, you know, easy to get going. So it's basically budget friendly. But if you do put a lot of currency into them, they'll absolutely wreck face. And of course, they're well balanced between clear speed and boss killing. So let's get on to it. All right, so the first build that we got here is Armageddon Brand. Now, brands are very easy to build with because they have so much power with barely any investment. Essentially meaning it's perfect for a starter build in a league like this. Now, I play Storm Brand and it was really quick, it was really fun, but I believe it got a bit of a nerf. But I've never played Armageddon Brand, which is like, you know, the big ass meteors just dropping and shit. Looks really cool, really flashy, and I've never tried it before, so I want to go for it this league. Well, the way you build it is essentially the same as almost any other character. So I went, of course, with Hierophant. I believe he has Hierophant. Because he has brand-related things and spell-based things. So I went with Sign of Purpose. You can cast an additional brand. Now, don't be confused with this. You can cast, I believe, up to like 5 or 6 brands, but only one brand can attach to an enemy and deal damage. The only way to get around this is if you take Runebinder, which of course we do. Means a brand can now attach, an additional brand can attach to an enemy, so that means you have a total of 2 brands. You see his damage, you would then double it. This build right now technically has like 1.2 million with barely anything in it. If you look at the gear, I should go into it in a second. So when you see cast an additional brand, don't get too excited, as more for clear speed rather than a single target, but you know, it's still beneficial. You want to be able to cast as much as you can, so when you recall them, then you spread out, they're going to clear a fuck ton more than just 1 or 2 brands, you know. Okay, so enemies take 10% increased damage for each of the brands attached to them. We have 2 brands attached, so that's 20% increased damage. Brand recall has 30% increased cooldown recovery. You can recall it very quickly. I have other things to increase this as well, but we'll go little by little, step by step. And then brand attachment range essentially means that if you put a brand on the floor, how far can they attach to an enemy and start dealing damage? You want as much as possible. That way you don't really have to like kill yourself by casting really far away. You can cast it, you know, pretty near to you, and then you just, you know, just go on by themselves, you know? It also means that if when an enemy dies and they're left on the floor, they can attach to one further away really easily, allowing for a chain reaction to occur much, much better. Then we have Conviction of Power. This gives you endurance charges when you get a power charge, 25% chance. Chance to get 50% chance to get a power charge when you summon a totem. Now, unfortunately, because of Runebinder, we're not using any totems. I hate that, honestly. I would love to use a totem. But you know, what can you do about it? Doubling your damage is more important than just a totem. And then 50% chance to get a power charge if you or your totems kill an enemy. Brands are considered to be by you, so you will get unleash effects and things like other such. So when you cast a brand and they kill something, you have 50% chance to get a power charge, percent chance to get a power charge, and then that 15% chance to get a power charge now has a 25% chance to get an endurance charge. So essentially, while mapping, you will have power charges and endurance charges. Very nice. Now, I also want Illuminated Devotion, excuse me. They give you increased AoE. Armageddon Brand is an AoE spell. It's a fire AoE spell. So area effect is very nice. You want spell damage loses life when you have Arcane Surge. Why not? Might as well have some life. You know, Warlords got nerfed to fucking hell. Can't even use it with spells anymore. So this is pretty good. And then increased spell damage, we have Arcane Surge. So question, how do you get Arcane Surge, right? Well, luckily for us, you get Arcane Surge when you and your enemies hit an enemy with a spell. So if you cast a brand and that brand hits an enemy, you now have Arcane Surge. Very easy, very well played. And then you're immune to elemental elements, which means you don't need
to have shock, freeze, chill,
or anything in a flask.
Fuck yeah.
Pretty cool. I liked it a lot. So let's start with, of course, Hierophant. Now, I didn't want to take any of the starter builds, the starter lines, because they're absolute trash. So we're going to go with easy one. Spell damage, mana, spell damage, elemental. It is a fire build. So that works. You want to pick up Retribution, come down to get the life, get the AoE, get the spell and spell crit and cast speed. It's elemental damage, a little bit of res, very nice. Come down here, get the life, pick up the jewel socket. You kind of have to go through it. Sorry. You don't have to put anything if you don't have anything. Just stick whatever the hell you can. Elemental damage, elemental, and this is really good. Penetration, you want as much as possible. Hell yeah.
Penetration.
Okay, sorry, I had to say it. And then Root Binder, because this is actually the main thing you're going for at the beginning of the game. You want two brands to attach as quick as possible, so get that as soon as you can. Then come back up. Do not pick up Mind Over Matter until you have more mana. Your mana increases and your life increases the base value as you level up. So early on, you're not going to have a lot of mana for this thing to be effective. Do not pick it up until probably like level 60 plus, until you have at least like 1,000 mana or something, you know? But pick up the life and mana region. Pick up the this explosive runes. It gives you brand damage, cast additional brand for clear speed, and then brand attachment range. Every single brand node, honestly, is going to be that combination of mods. So if you look out for that, that's what you're going to get. Life and mana, spell crit, AoE, life. These are the totem brand combination of crit. Pick it up. Very good. Man, look at that. 100% increased global crit chance if you summon a totem recently. I caught some bullshit. I'm pretty sure if you use like Searing Bond, you can just drop a totem since it has a maximum of 2. And you just get 100% increased global spell crit. But it's up to you. I was really limited in sockets. But hey, you do what you do, man. Prodigal Perfection gives you about 50% spell damage if you have 1,000 mana, I believe. So don't pick it up until you have a considerable amount of mana. I think even early on it's still kind of decent, but again, I wouldn't do it till later. Arcane Will gives you increased maximum 4% of maximum mana as extra energy shield. The reason we want this is because we are playing Eldritch Battery. I love this setup because Eldritch Battery is not your mana pool, so your ES is your mana pool, and what this means is that you'll be using your ES to cast your mana, to cast a spell. Excuse me, I'm having a stroke up here. So what that means is technically your mana is basically allowed to be reserved fully because you're not using it as your mana source. So that means you can use more auras and things as such. But what also means is with Mind Over Matter, that ES that is now covering that mana pool will also go in turn like mana and protect your life, 30% of it, of course. So if all your mana is reserved, then 30% of that ES will be used for Mind Over Matter. But if you do have mana, it does take the mana as well after the ES runs out. So it's kind of like a double layer. It's really cool. Now, keep in note like how ES works in every scenario. Chaos damage bypasses it through completely. So if you take chaos damage, it'll go directly to your life and mana with Mind Over Matter. But yeah, pick it up once you have a decent amount of ES. I think even when you have 200 ES, I think it's worth picking up. So you do you. Pick it up when you think you need it and you have enough energy shield. Crit multi. It's only crit multi, so don't pick it up until you have enough crit chance, but if it's in the way and you want to, just go for it. Maximum energy to maximum life. Again, we're kind of a hybrid build, ES and life, so you want to pick it up. More brand attachment stuff and damage. And this is very important, brand activation frequency. So the way that brands work is that when you cast a brand, the amount of times that brand's going to activate and hit the enemy because it attaches to them for a certain duration is based off your cast speed and your brand activation frequency. So this build needs as much cast speed, which you're going to see in my gear setup now, and brand activation frequency. So pick it up. Life and ES, spell crit, and then all this is life, spell crit, and cast speed, spell damage, a little bit of spell damage, and a lot of dexterity, which you do need. Excuse me. Very nice. So now let's go into your items. So now your items are going to be two wands. Now your wands want spell damage, spell crit, and try to get for like 100% spell crit, and then cast speed, a crap ton of cast speed. Get as much cast speed as you can. On top of that, if you have more money, you can put fire damage to spells and gain percent of non-chaos damage as extra chaos damage. This is fire, so it would work. If you can craft it, go for it. Other than that, crit multi would work as well. That's very nice. Now, the top setup, you could probably use void batteries if you have a crap ton of money. But even then, I don't think they actually give you more damage because we don't have a lot of power charges. So if you do want to use void battery, you would have to change the skill tree to get more power charges. Just keep that in note. I don't think it's worth it, but you do you. Helmet, this is such an easy pick for me, honestly, because this unique item is so fucking cheap. It gives you 40% fire damage at max roll, a bit of life, goes up to 70. cold resistances, armor, and then you cannot be frozen or chilled. Now, that doesn't really matter because you have Arcane Surge because of the Hierophant, but hey, it's there for damage and life. If you don't want this, you can pick up a rare chest, a rare helmet, and enchant it, you know, if you get an enchantment. So you don't need this. I just put it in there because it's cheap, affordable. You can get it early on. Well, not really early on, 155 requirement, but like as you hit maps, you can buy it for really cheap. Now, because Armageddon Brand's an AoE spell, Karga's Jack works great with it, increases your AoE, your damage, life, and then a little bit of res. And then, of course, it has a good combination because it's an it's energy shield, so it requires int, so blue sockets, are easier to get. Very nice, but if you do want, you can use Combs Heart if you don't give a shit about the, you know, the amount of sockets you're using. And you can use Belly of the Beast or just a rare chest piece. And now there's also the option of a rare chest piece. I don't know how it's gonna work now because we don't know the mod pool of this league of the Conquerors. A shaped chest piece back then had a chance of getting the 1% base crit added to your spells. If that can still roll, I'm pretty sure they're not gonna take that out onto whatever Conqueror or Exile boss that you can get it from, you know, their influence. That would work too, the chest piece with that crit mod on it. But on top of that, you have gloves. You want to get fingerless spell gloves because they give you spell damage, easy pick, a little bit of ES, and then you want life and res. Boots, life, res, movement speed, easy going. Now your amulet, your two most starved stats are strength and dexterity, so pick up something that has strength and dexterity as much as you need, with spell damage, crit multi, and life. Ring, you want to get a ring with life, resistances, and then if you can, look for an cursed enemies with level 7 final ability on hit. This drops from Delph. They tend not to be too expensive, so find one that recovers, like, covers what you need, and then buy it. Of course, the more things, the more expensive, but it should be fine. And there's other ring. This is from the synthesis and stuff. These can be pretty cheap, but also be pretty expensive early in the league. For now, just use a normal rare ring, kind of like this one, without the, you know, the curse on hit. But if you do get one, you can pick one up and try to get for Hail to Vash, increased buff effect, and because it gives you more spell damage. And look for a reduced mana reserved. That's kind of like the two best setup. If it's too expensive, don't bother with it. Just stick to Mark of the Shaper if you can get it for it. But that will require your other ring to be an other item. Just keep that in mind. It's more expensive. Or if you want the cheap out route, just pick up a normal ring with fire damage. Or an opal ring if you want slightly more. You have a lot of options. Your belt, obviously, Stingy and Vise is going to be the best slot. So life, res, and elemental damage from fossils if you want. If you have extra currency. Your jewel, you know, you want crit multi, life, and the fire damage of spells. Cast speed works too. A bunch of other shit. I think cast speed might be better. So if you have cast speed, if you crit recently, go for it. Wise Oak, easy. You want that. Sweet, sweet.
Penetration.
Diamond flask, silver flask for diamond for crit, silver for movement speed and cast speed. Quicksilver because you want to go zoom zoom. And you want to use a life flask at the last point. And then you have another jewel socket, just pick whatever the hell you want. Look for a jewel with fire damage, area damage, spell damage while dual wielding, fire crit multi, life. You get the gist of it. You know what your damage sources are. I hope you do. You should know by now. But yeah, those are your sources. Now your skills. Body armor. Armageddon Brand, you want Conk Effect, Immolate, because you're going to be ignited. Immolate adds a fuck ton of damage. But this means you can't use Elemental Focus. It's still better. We'll deal with it. Control Destruction, Inspiration, because as you spend mana, you're gonna have increased elemental damage and 8% crit chance. They got nerfed, so I lower it to the level of the nerf. So the new level 20 is like the level 18 version of it. It's still really good. And then Energy Leech just allows you to not only get damage because it gives you 24% more damage, well 39% more damage while leeching energy shield. And since you're using your energy shield as mana, you're technically always leeching it, so it's actually a really good node pick. It's kind of like mana leech, but that gives you damage. So that's why I really like this setup. And that's basically your 6th link. Now, you can drop Inspiration and put Energy Leech as your 5th link. If you're having mana issues, keep that a note. So you don't really have to use Inspiration until later. Your boots, you want to use Zeltry and then Hail to Vash. The reason why I told you about that ring was because if you get that ring with a reduced mana reservation, then you can actually fit some Inskitter bots in there for the chill and the shock. Because even with the level 3 Enlightened, you don't have enough. That's why I have it here. So for sure, use these two. And if you do happen to get that ring, then put some in Skitter bots. But yeah, this thing gives you a crap ton of damage because of the 12% more spell fire damage. Just things are. Now, I think Summon Skitter bots is a better damage source, but it's not as reliable, I guess you can say. You mess around with it. They both work. So if you really prioritize one or the other, go for it. Some Mosquito Bots might be the better option, but Helldivash is there if you want just always damage, you know? Let's move on. Wand, you want precision. Level 1, you only want the accuracy doesn't do anything, so you want the crit chance. Flame Dash and faster casting for movement speed. Your Wand 2 is going to have Brand Recall. Now, Brand Recall allows you to actually recall the brands into your position. I have it enhanced with Empower and Enhance. Don't bother level 3, it's too expensive. Just get a level 2 for now. They're super cheap, Corrupted or something like that. Even the level 3 Corrupted eventually will be super cheap. But this is basically to make them, that the quality makes it, you know, gives it cooldown recovery speed. So that means you can cast it more often. So that's basically your best bet. If you want, you can put faster casting or something like that. But this is basically the best thing. Your helmet. Now, Hypo Scorching right here with Cast While Channel, Wave of Conviction, and Infuse Channeling. The way this works is you want to cast Scorching Ray and then give him the fire exposure real quick. While you're casting that, it'll cast Wave of Conviction, which reduces their resistances by 25%. And because it's a channeling skill, Infuse Channeling gives you 10% more damage of that spell type, which is fire. So that affects your brand. And the reason why this is so cool is because brands fucking are easy and they do all the damage themselves. You literally cast it and you sit there and you do nothing.
Nothing. So,
what happens is, while that's just doing his work, you just sit there, freaking Scorching Ray, and as that's happening, you're lowering their resistances by a fuck ton. 25% minus this, and then this also gives 25 minus 50. Yeah, that's a pretty good buff, in my opinion. So now you're not just sitting there running around like a fucking idiot. You're casting Scorching Ray and reduces their resistances while Armageddon's effing things up. Hell yeah. Now your gloves are going to be Orb of Storms, Power Charge on Crit. You can use Storm Brand, but then that affects your brand attachment, so I don't recommend it, just letting you know. Orb of Storms, Power Charge on Crit, increase Crit Strikes for that crit. And then if you notice, I didn't put Combustion in my main setup. The reason for that is because Combustion is kind of like, you don't have to have it on your main setup, and people don't realize that. You can have it on a different setup, and if that setup ignites them, it's a debuff, and the enemy has less res because of it, which affects the brand. So if you just put Orb of Storms on the enemy, and it crits, because you have increased crit chance, it will ignite, and then you have Power Charge on Crit. Now, for this to work, keep in mind, for this to work, you have to have fire damage added to your spells. And fortunately for us, you could use Anger instead of Zeltry. Let me add it here and see what type of damage that would do to us. You could. It might be better. I didn't even think about this, to be honest. Excuse me while I'm making a build. It has less damage. Anger does add fire to your spells. But you don't need that. What you could do is just add like that little jewel that I had there. Where is it? This thing that adds fire damage to spells. With that, you will ignite using Orb of Storms. So keep that in mind. You have to have fire damage added to spells for this to work. With that, it'll ignite. And then because it ignites, it combusts them, I guess, and reduces the res, which affects the brand as well. So there's a lot
of penetration
in this build, as you can see. So the damage is really good. And then Arcane Surge, this is just a simulation of this thing. As you can see here, it's red. That means it's not working. So I have to, you know, kind of put it in like my own little note here. And then just the ring with the family ability on it. So yeah, that covers basically the Armageddon build. This is going to be a long video. I apologize beforehand. Excuse me. By the way, all the links are in the description below. Everything. All the POBs. Let's move on. Now, what you see in front of you is going to be my starter, because it's going to be absolutely disgustingly broken, is Blast Rain Deadeye. Now, Blast Rain got changed. It now does less base damage, but now it increases your, what do you call it? It increases your projectiles, I guess you can say. So it now, instead of being considered a blast, it's considered a projectile, which means things like additional projectiles from your bow, like Death's Opus, and your Corrupted Quiver, Dying Sun, will work on Blast Rain now, which is absolutely amazing. So now let's start with this, because this build's fucking stupid. Before I know, if I know you guys saw that Artillery Ballista came out, and it's basically the same freaking thing as Blast Rain in Totem format. So of course, because I'm a genius, I had to add it to the build, at least as the 4-link, possibly 5-link. I don't remember now, I have to check the skills. I believe it's a 5-link. because it is skilled the exact same way as Blast Rain's, affected by arrows. They're both fire. They're both AoE. Like, I don't... Why would you do that? So now you have your own Blast Rain plus three freaking totems, because artillery totems actually have a maximum of three totems. So you have three totems and you going raining fucking hell on an enemy, which is absolutely busted. And as you can see here, Blast Rain by itself is already doing over 2 million. So why do you need a totem, Leo? Who cares? More damage. Yeah, let's go into it. So, Deadeye, easy. You want to get fast and deadly for that amazing 50% more global accuracy rating. That means you have to have no accuracy in your gear, zip, nada whatsoever, and you have 100% chance to hit. Very nice. Now, on top of that, you get attack speed, projectile damage, which affects it now. And then the blink arrow, so you can cast it more often, the recovery speed. Tailwinds. Tailwind works in the way that, because it's a multiplier, the more base movement speed and base attack speed, like the increased attack speed that you have, the more it is going to affect you. Which is how it works. You know, more damage is not going to be better than increased damage if you have zero increased damage. Because zero times zero is zero times whatever more multiplier is still zero. So, I mean, in this case, you always have a base. You get the point, but it's not going to be as effective, is what I'm trying to say. It's not really going to be zero. But in this case, we have a lot of movement speed that I get in the tree that's efficient. Excuse me, that I picked up. So that means I want to get this effective tailwind is going to increase my movement speed more because of that. So this allows you to go zoom zoom and, you know, just kill shit super quick. It's gonna be a very fast build, which I really like it. So it's really good. This build's gonna be perfect for people who really want to go super fast and do a lot of damage. So that's that. And then this build, this thing, who the fuck cares about it? I don't really give a shit about that. And then endless munitions. This is the important part, the accuracy rating. I guess you don't really need it because of this thing, but hey, it's there, benefit. And AoE, because Blast Rain and the artillery totem is an AoE spell, so a little bit of AoE won't hurt anybody. But the main reason is skills fire and additional projectile. This is the key item. More projectiles means more damage. Okay, more power, baby. No, I shouldn't say that. I shouldn't fucking say that. I mean, it's not copyrighted, right? Okay, whatever. You know where that's from if you see it. Now, you know, start with life. This build has less life, so I do not recommend picking up the damage sources up here, even though it does work. I recommend getting life. Pick up here, get our Heart of Oak, pick up Ballista Mastery, and then go for Aspect of the Eagle. This little setup gives you about 8% movement speed and damage and accuracy, a little bit of life. And this is basically by being efficient, getting as much movement speed efficiently as possible. Pick it up, very nice to pick. Pick up here, pick up Herbalism. Now, in this scenario, it doesn't really matter which way you go, but it doesn't matter. I suggest going right. Let's just say that. Herbalism. But if you decide to go left, all power to you. It doesn't matter. Come down. You get Lethality. You get that crit. Early on, you will get Burning Arrow and Ice Shot to level up with. So elemental stuff will work if you want to pick it up. Pick it up. Here in the bottom is the attack speed. I recommend that one. The crit chance on top. Pick it up. If you don't really give a shit about the crit early on, you don't have to. But hey, it's you. Same thing with this. This crit chance, crit multi. I don't recommend this picking this up until later. It's not that efficient early on when you have a really little crit. But yeah. Now, this little section is complicated, so I'm going to go over it. Lionized Fall converts melee and melee weapon type modifiers into bow. And the reason why this is so good right here is because this little area right here from the shadows, this is all daggers. 10% chance to get phasing on kill. You get accuracy, attack speed, and damage. I mainly did it for the attack speed, by the way. This affects bows now. On top of that, this is the most important part. All this spell crit multi and crit chance multi, whatever the hell. Crit chance, crit multi, and 10% chance to blind. Hell yeah. Amazing, by the way. And then leech. Leech, all this is not gonna affect your bow character. It's absolutely amazing. But Lioness Fall, this league will most likely be very expensive due to the bow stuff. So I did provide an additional build in the POE below for people who don't want to waste the money. Everything's in the link below. You're gonna see it. There's gonna be like bow build without jewel and with jewel, but right now I'm just showing you the jewel version. Most likely what you're gonna do is, instead of taking all these nodes and taking these nodes and taking this jewel socket, you're gonna come down here and pick up these little life leech nodes, right? And then you're most likely gonna pick up a little bit more damage, like up here and going up to get more life. It's just straight up less damage. We'll probably pick up World of Blaze as well. It'll be in the link below ECU for you to check out either way. But yeah, that's the gist of this little section here. It's really good, really powerful. I recommend you doing it if you have the money. I don't know why I picked that up. Forces of Nature, elemental damage weapons, and penetration. That's sweet.
Penetration.
Revenge of the Hunted, life and physical damage, very nice. Go back up here, Fangs of the Viper, movement speed. Pick this shit up, gives you fizz damage, life. You know, again, you pick this up if you have the jewel. If you do not have the jewel, do not pick this up, by the way. Come down here left. Get the attack speed, get the life, get the crit, and that's pretty much it. Oh, and then you come down here. My bad, I forgot the bottom part. I get the life, get this little farsight, increases damage of bows, accuracy and attack speed. Get point blank. Point blank works with blast rain, so you do 30% more damage. Unfortunately, it got nerfed. It used to be 50, but now it's 30. But yeah, it's still worth picking up 30%. Come on. So you're gonna be up to their faces, and you know you're gonna do a fuck ton more damage, especially the totems. Totems. Oh, you can summon a totem right in front of them, and it'll get the 30% more damage. So if you really want to play it safe, just put the totems, and then cast them a little bit further away. But instead of being 30, it'll be like 10 or 20. Who cares? Still really good. Get the life. Get the jewel. Projectile damage. Accuracy, attack speed, and more life. And that's the gist of this skill tree. Bandit of choice is Alera. I don't know if I said it before, but the bandit of choice for the other build is also Alera. Essentially, if you're a crit build, pick up Alera. Anything else, get the two passives. There, you learn bandits. It's that easy. Yeah. So now let's go over your items real quick. Obviously, the most cheapest and best option is going to be Death's Opus. It gives you a lot of crit chance. And attack speed, but the damage is not bad. But the most important is two additional arrows. Two additional arrows will give you two additional arrows for both your totems. And since you have three totems, I guess it's six additional arrows and your blast rain. Very nice. Signal fire. This is a physical build. I mean, a fire build. Excuse me. So you want that 30% of physical damage after fire. That's the max roll. It goes lower than that. But and it gives you attack speed. Very nice. The only downside to this is that it has no life, but the damage is just too good to pass up. And if you get that over the plus additional arrow, very nice, very nice. Sarkandja, best in slot for life and attack speed and crit chance. If you're lacking or starving for resistances, you can pick up a normal helmet, or you can pick up Herm's resolve choice, I guess, if you want to pick it up. Or you can pick up a normal helmet with life and rise. Body armor, you have Carcass Jack, because it does work, because it's an AoE spell. Belly of the Beast and Combs Heart. I feel like I'm repeating myself, but hey, they're both fire skills. What do you want from me? Yeah. I suggest Belly of the Beast, cheapest, and it gives you the sockets, and his build wants all the sockets it gets. So if that was up to me, I would pick Belly of the Beast. That's just my recommendation. Up to you if you want to follow it. Tomb Fist. You can use gloves with fizz and attack speed, but they don't give as much damage as Tomb Fist with Intimidate. I'm not talking about the two socket. The two socket's too expensive. Get a one socket, it should be pretty fucking cheap. They're very common. And just put a Searching Eye Jewel. No, the Murder's Eye Jewel on it. With Intimidate. Get Intimidate on it. This allows enemies to take, allows them, and makes enemies take 10-15% increased damage, which technically is a more multiplier. So yeah, from attack hits, by the way. So pick it up, put a jewel on it. I put Searching Eye here. It's supposed to be a Murderous Eye Jewel, by the way. So just that note, it should be a Murderous Eye Jewel. Your boots, life res, movement speed. Your amulets, you want strength and int, those are your two stats you're starving for. You want fizz, crit multi, and life. And if you get elemental damage of attack skills, that works as well. Rings, get whatever stat you're starving for, like strength and int with fizz, life, and res. Mark of the Elder works if it still drops and if you want to deal with the ring. Otherwise, steel rings are basically your best in slot. Your belt will be life, res, wed. You can craft it. It's super easy to get with, of course, a jewel and a abyss jewel. Now, your flasks are kind of a little bit starving for, and I kind of hate it. You have Wise Oak for the penetration. Again, sweet, sweet.
Penetration.
Dying Sun for the extra projectiles. This is going to be absolutely fucking expensive. I'm just saying it right now. I predict it'll be super expensive because Shaper doesn't really exist anymore unless you get the fragments from like a modifier on the map that allows Shaper to spawn or one of his guardians to spawn. So if this is still possible to get, I don't even know if there's a divination card for it. You had to correct me on that. Go for it if you have the money, but otherwise just use a silver non-slot flask for now, because we're lacking a non-slot flask. And then use you can also use Azir's Promise, up to you. It's here, all little options. Diamond flask for crit, and then Quicksilver for zoom because you're a bow build, you don't really have a lot of movement modifiers. And then a life flask, whatever life flask you want to use. And then your jewels are mostly going to be crit multi with fire skills, crit multi, life, projectile damage, AoE damage. There's a lot of shit, you know, you should know. And that's pretty much it. Okay, let's go to the skills. So this is going to get really complicated. Bow, you have, this is basically the best setup. You have the bow, your Death's Opus is going to have blast rain, immolate, Concentrated Effect, Elemental Damage of Attacks, Sword Projectile, and then Inspiration. Yes, I forgot to tell you in the other build, there is the Awakened, like if you look here, Awakened Elemental Damage. I'm not going to expect you guys to get that early on in the game, so I'm not going to put it. I'd rather have a lot of damage without those Awakened Jewels, and then when I do get them, it's even better. Don't base your build around shit you're probably not going to have. That's the way I build anyway. So that's your 6th link. I'll drop Inspiration if it's your last one. Boots. It came out with Ensnaring Arrow. Ensnaring Arrow is really cool because enemies take 20% increased projectile damage from attack hits, and it slows them the fuck down. So I put Ensnaring Arrow with Mirage Archer, Curse on Hit, Projectile Weakness. So you literally hit them with Ensnaring Arrow, you ensnare them, they take damage, and then Mirage Archer will just keep doing it while you're going ham with your totems and your blast rain. Hell the fuck yeah. Easy. Automated Curse on Hit and more damage multiplier. Now your helmet. You want Herald Device linked with Onslaught. Onslaught works with, it does work. So with Herald Device, if they blow up, that has a chance of giving you Onslaught. We don't have an Onslaught flask, so that's why I put it in here. Then you want Blink Arrow, then Anger. Anger is going to be your best slot, like literally multiplier for damage. But yeah, now let's go on to your gloves. Your gloves are going to be Toon Fist, one socket, Abyss Jewel. So it's going to have three sockets to work with. You want Cast and Damage Taken, Summon Ice Golem, and Wave of Conviction. Wave of Conviction most likely will be fire because of Signal Fire and converts 50% of physical to fire. So for sure, it's going to do more damage to fire. You're going to reduce their res by 25%. Sweet.
Penetration.
Now here's where it gets kind of tricky. Your body armor is going to have a 5-link totem with artillery, elemental damage to attacks, immolate, again, combustion, because now that the totem is going to be doing fire damage, if the totem ignites, it will makes them have a debuff that reduces their resistances by 19%, which affects your blast rain, conk effect, and there you go. This works well. Now, which does mean that if while you're clearing, you're not going to have combustion, but for clear speed, we're going to be using Ice Shot. I'm going to that right now. And then your last socket, your little 6 socket for on the 5-link is going to be precision buff. Again, if you don't have a 5-link or whatever, just lower the links on the artillery ballistic. It can be a 1-link and then put everything else in whatever available sockets you have. Now, here is where you want a weapon swap with a bow. It doesn't have to be another Death's Opus. It can just be a Death's Harp. It can be anything. Just use a bow that has decent amount of damage and at least has a 4-link. You know, you don't have to spend a lot of money. This is your bow 2 setup. All you do is swap weapons while you're clearing. You're going to be using Ice Shot with Immolate, Elemental Damage with Attack Skills, GMP, and if you have a 5th link, Inspiration, or, you know, just lower mana. Now, if you don't have Signal Fire, Immolate's probably a questionable option because you're not going to be dueling any fire damage. But you do have Anger. So I guess it works. Never mind. You have Anger. But yeah. Again, do not waste a lot of money on your second slot. If you're a big money baller, go for it and get another Death's Opus. It will last you quite a bit. But that's pretty much the OP bow build. This thing is going to be absolutely fucking ridiculous. I expect to blow up a lot of shit with this. So if you want to have fun, I suggest build this bow. It can be pretty expensive, but it can also be pretty cheap. So have some fun. And then lastly, the build melee. Now, I played this build last league and I never made a build guide on it because I wasn't able to with all the crap. As you can see, my setup changed. So it's going to be, where the hell is it? Lacerate. I am an idiot. Where the hell is it? Right here. Impale Lacerate. Now, the reason I'm saying this is because Impale is incredibly powerful and you do not need a lot of gear for it to work. And then Lacerate, because Lacerate has a lot of fucking AoE, more than Cyclone in my opinion, and is really cool. So you're gonna be a duelist, obvious reasons, champion. You have 20% chance to impale. You they last 2 additional hits, and then if you impale recently, you have a fuck ton of armor, and then you do added physical damage per impale. It's just common sense. You pick this shit up. Inspirational, you want this because banner skills have no mana and this has a lot of auras. You're gonna see, but it will work. You're gonna see it. This has a lot of buffs. I was really proud of this build. This build does, it says here, what, 2 million? It's 2 million and it's not even taken into account Lacerate, right? Lacerate is busted, guys. I mean, not Lacerate, Impale is busted and it's so cheap. I don't have Impale active. As you can see, it's doing nothing and I have 2 million and I don't have a simulation anywhere to simulate this node. So keep that in mind. And then you have First to Strike. Your hits permanently intimidate enemies around full life. So when you hit them, you're gonna intimidate them. And then it's kind of like an oh shit. It's not really a button, just an oh shit moment. If you take a lot of damage, adrenaline kicks in, you recover a crap ton of your life back, and then you go ham. You just go ham. You're gonna notice that you're gonna dip the fuck out with a leap slam so quick. You're like, what the hell happened? And it was adrenaline. It was good for survivability. You can try to add sockets somewhere and do like this little what's that called again with a curse. It's passing me by now. It's that gem that when you put a curse on it, blasphemy, there you go. You put a blasphemy setup and then you reserve some of your life with blood magic. So you then go to low life when you want to on point, and then adrenaline procs and you recover your life again. And then you have the buff for like 20 seconds. It's up to you if you want to do it. I didn't see it necessary. I don't want to deal with that risky shit. So it's up to you if you want to do it. And then fortify. You're gonna fortify your leap slam. So when you fortify them, when you leap slam on top of an enemy, you get this buff for can be stunned, attack speed, and a lot of armor and evasion. Still really good. Now, if you do want to drop like this thing and you just get perma fortify, you can. It does help out because you're not gonna have perma fortify up all the time. But yeah, let's continue. Duelist, you're gonna pick up here, get this life, get the damage, get this mashup arena, get the life, get this little part of the gladiator, and then you come down here for the two-handed weapons, because this is a two-handed sword build, by the way. I don't know why that's there. Excuse me. And then pick up the life. You want to pick up all these two-handed and sword nodes that give you accuracy, crit chance, and damage. And then you're also looking for a lot of area of effect and the plus one to melee range, which makes your lacerate fucking
huge, boy. Big, thick, huge.
Okay. Or I guess I say dummy thick. Get the life, more sword and accuracy, and then all this little sword accuracy. I mean, sword, does it give you accuracy? I don't know. Sword attack speed and sword multi and crit chance, and then life. And then we move on left. I'm here. You want to pick up everything that has impale. So this has impale. Pick it up. You're looking for a lot of impale effectiveness. It's going to be really good. This has a lot of AoE. That's why I picked it up. You don't have to, but I love AoE, boy. Pick it up. Crit chance, life, soul of steel. You're dumb if you don't pick this shit up. It gives you plus one to max all rise. Pick that shit up, bro. It's a lot better. If you don't know what that means, don't worry about it. It's just very worth the investment. Here again, more crit multi, crit chance, and yeah. Up here, get the accuracy, because this build does need accuracy. You do have 100% chance to hit. You're gonna see all my builds have 100% chance to hit, and it increases attack speed and physical damage. You get this juggernaut, which has life. Now there's a watcher's eye here. You don't need it. I picked it up because it was cheap and I had the extra money from it. But yeah, just use a jewel with, you know, life, physical damage, crit multi, yada yada. You know what to pick, attack speed, whatever works. More crit, life, more damage, more life. Very simple build to start with. Let's go on to the items. Now I did use a Starforge for this because honestly it's a fizz build. Starforge is a no-brainer. Starforge might be, again, insanely expensive. So if that is the case, I recommend using a Terminus Est. You see right here. Now, it will be a lot cheaper and the damage won't be as crazy, but you're still gonna be doing over 1 million without Impale. So you're most likely gonna be doing about 3 million. And then you can go in here and then click Frenzy Charges and you're almost back to where you started. The only thing that you kind of lose out is that they won't be shocked. That's what the majority of the damage is. Starforge does so much damage that you actually shock even Shaper. That's what I'm saying. I don't know how big the shock is, but you will shock them. So if you are Terminus S, your damage will still be very, very good in this build. And you have a lot more attack speed. So again, you know, you play around with it. But if you do have a lot of money, get the Starforge. Get the Starforge. But the Terminus S is for the budget best in slot sword, unless you do some crazy mastercrafting crap. Helmet, you're looking for life and resistances, and I needed int, so I got int. Your chest piece, now this build does need a chest piece with crit chance, so if that's still able to get, I'm pretty sure it's still able to get, just look for a crappy base with the influence of whatever mod pool has that attacks have 1.34% chance to crit and start crafting with alteration orbs. Best way. If not, go to your 5-link or 6-link setup that we're going to cover very quick and just put increased crit strikes on it, and that should be fine. Your damage will be lowered, but you still be destroying shit. So deal with that. Now your gloves. You can honestly use you wouldn't use Tomb Fist because Intimidate Turidian and Gladiator. You could use gloves like any gloves that have attack speed, fist damage to attacks and life. But if you want the sweet pops and you want a really good clear speed, I recommend getting Haemophilius. They give you chance to bleed, attack damage, and then the pops. It's very satisfying. Again, this is from my previous build, so I have attacks have points, whatever, 70% chance to crit to the base. That's a very expensive corruption. Don't bother with it. Just ignore it. But yeah. Your boots, life, res, movement speed. Well, actually, you don't need movement speed. You can craft it because you're going to be leap slamming with a lot of attack speed. So you don't need movement speed. Don't overpay for it. And get strength if you need it. Amulet, again, you're looking for dexterity and intelligence. Get fizz, get crit multi, and try to get an extra prefix so you can craft. Non-challenging skills have -9 to mana cost. It's going to help you out a lot. So go for that. You can craft it on your ring if you can. Now your rings, mines are over the top. Again, you don't need this crazy shit. You can just get life and res and the stat. But look for attack speed, is damage to attacks, things like that. And then look for another ring like that has from the Delph that has cursed enemies of level 5 vulnerability on hits. This will give you vulnerability on it. It's very strong. It's not needed again. Again, this build does plenty of damage without this crazy investment. So it will still work very well without all this stuff. But if you do put the money, you will be rewarded greatly. And that's the point I'm trying to get across. But also look for accuracy. Because you're trying to hit that 100% chance to hit. And then your belt, obviously, stingy advice. You want life, res. And then if you have the fossil, get the increased global fizz damage. If not, just use a rustic slash or a leather belt. Ignore that. My friends are bothering me. And then you want sulfur flask, lion's roar because more damage, silver flask for onslaught, and then a diamond for crit. And then your jewel uses whatever the fuck you want. Okay. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. This is gonna be a long video. I'm trying to explain everything in detail. And then lacerate. You want lacerate, concentrated effect, brutality, impale. And again, it doesn't even do any damage. Because the only thing affecting it is the 16% more damage. So the impale is not even in the calculation, just letting you know. So there's a lot more than that. Multi-strike, melee fizz. Your helm is going to be leap slam, blood and sand, because you want that area damage and area effect. Fortify, faster attacks. This build's going to have a lot of auras, just letting you know. Boots, pride. You're going to have a level, you don't need a level 3 in Latin. You're going to get a level 2. Flesh and stone and maim. And then your sword is going to be volunteers or warchief. Ruthless, melee fizz, brutality, and conk effect. If you have a 5, if you have a 4 link only, just drop one of these things. Probably ruthless, whichever one gives you the least amount of damage. And your last socket for that sword will be blood rage. Now your gloves, you're gonna have summon ice golem, cast some damage taken, and also precision and dread banner. Dread banner gives you that sweet impale. So go for that. And then of course your ring has that. But this build is incredibly strong. It is absolutely disgusting. I highly recommend it. So if you can do it, go for it. But yeah, that pretty much covers the three builds. Again, it's a crit build, so all three builds are crit. All the links are in the description below. I'm gonna be streaming this shit because I'm hyped as fuck. I'm going blast train. If you want to see some crazy ass arrows exploding a lot of crap, hit me up in twitch.tv/Colgaris or Colgaras or however the fuck you want to say my name. Yeah, I'm ready to light shit up, and I hope you guys are excited for this league, because I'm excited. And as the league continues, I will be making more builds and more detailed spill guides on everything and how I min-max everything from the start. So if you guys enjoy this, everything will be linked below, as I said, the timestamps as well. And have fun grinding out there, boys. Peace out.